just the next speaker, but a very dear friend. If we probably retrace 16 years back, we would not have, or more than that, I wouldn't have imagined introducing him here. So Mr. Avinash Mohanty and I studied in the same school, and along with my elder brother, we all prepared for the IIT JEE entrance together. And then I went to IIT, he went to a college in Hyderabad. And then while I was probably studying and working in the US, he was fighting Maoists in Chattisgarh. He went into the IPS, and interestingly, he chose the IPS over IAS. Though his rank allowed him to take an IAS, he chose the IPS service. He comes from a family of IPS officers. And then over a period of time, he took various different positions. Currently, he is the DCP crime from Hyderabad. And unlike many speakers who have probably come here, Avinash is a person, typical policeman, point and shoot. Okay, so you'll not find too much of an intellectual kind of a brainstorming session, but it is typically how a policeman takes decisions in his regular life, how he looks at various police reforms, what's happening, what is the story of a policeman behind the scenes, right? We have a fear, right? Actually, police is supposed to assure us, but if you see a policeman, we get afraid. So what goes behind the policeman's life? What happens behind the curtains? This is what Avinash will reveal to all of us. I welcome Avinash Mohanty on stage.
Good afternoon, everybody. Before we start talking, or I start talking, I'll just do some search on the net. I'll just do two searches. I, in fact, did it before I came here. We'll do it again for everybody to just see how intellect flies out of the window when you work in police for 12 years. How do you put on that? Anyway, good read. I don't want to read anything good. How do you go back? I presume what I am seeing is coming on the net behind. On the screen behind. Okay, we'll search for two things. Okay, just have a look what you're seeing, okay. Generally kind of, I've just typed Police India kind of videos, okay. Okay, yeah, quite interesting stuff, yeah. Okay, I'll just do a different search now. I'll just replace the word with, yeah. Now you see the kind of things that come. Yeah? Do you notice a change, a difference? Yes? I ask myself the question, why are we so hated, so vilified, so ridiculed? Two organizations, both part of the government, both in uniform. Primary motto of both organizations is to serve the nation, though in different ways. But why is such a difference? Here you see mostly positive, bravery, gallantry and discipline and great things and about the army. And when you see about the police, what do you see? Police pitai, then police ka pitai, here a policeman taking a bribe, correct? What is the role of police? When we see so much, probably it's very important to understand what the police does. Then probably we can understand why what you're seeing is there. What's the role of a policeman or what's the role of police? Law and order, crime. Yeah, prevention, detection of crime and law and order. Some ancillary functions, collection of intelligence, internal security, all dovetailed into these two. These two are the primary two functions of police. But what does police do in India? Disaster relief, yes, VIP and protocol duties, and distribution of seeds, distribution of fertilizers. I'm not joking. Because if you distribute these things from a market yard or from the office of the development officer, block BD or something, the office will get looted. That's why police has to do it. Okay, then conflict resolution, that is one of the biggest and most time consuming aspects of police work. Conflict resolution, starting from husband-wife conflict to industrial conflict and everything that comes in between. Conflict resolution, which neither can be a crime. Husband-wife fighting cannot be a crime. Yes? Nor is an industrial dispute a crime if nobody is beating anybody or destroying any property. But police invariably comes into this. Yes? So we listed out disaster relief, some aspects of developmental work, conflict resolution, and we keep discussing. I think you will touch upon every aspect of public life where police either police intrudes into, either by choice or not so much by choice. Yes? When it does something which is much beyond its brief, then certainly every aspect of governance in this country, very simply put it, every aspect of governance is controlled by some law at the very top. There will be some law which will govern this working. Below that law will be something called as subordinate legislation. That is what we call rules. If there is an act, there will be rules commensurate with that act. And then again, subsequent to that rules, there would be something called as executive orders, that is government orders, in pursuance of those act and those rules. So every organization will have certain acts, certain rules, and then certain executive orders based on which it works. Now tell me, under which act or rule or executive order does police distribute seeds? None. Under which act or rule or executive order does police resolve a dispute between two neighbors? It is not a crime, doesn't get covered in IPC or CRPC anywhere, though CRPC to some extent, but many of these issues which come, hardly even you can talk about CRPC or IPC. But it's still, you are expected, if somebody goes to a police station, it's not resolved. What do you say? Bekar hai, police station, SHO is bekar, he doesn't take any interest in the work, in the community, nothing. This is simply to drive home the point that police does some things which are not envisaged for it, nor does it have the wherewithals, nor the resources. Resources, I don't mean manpower or vehicles or communications or something like that. Legal wherewithals. Everything has to be governed, otherwise it's illegal. What does typically police do in a rural area? Two parties go quarrel, go before police, dono ko ek ek lagaya, ghar bheja. Shant ho gaya, pura system, pura issue resolve ho gaya. Ab mere ko batao, under which act, which rule, which provision of law this is being done? Nothing, no. So, when a agency works, especially a government agency works without very specific charters, there are certain deviations which are bound to happen. And what public notices today, more often, or which is played out repeatedly and often in the public domain, are the deviations and not what is happening 90% of the time, professional, neat work. That's not played out. Now, I'll just put a little bit across, since we are discussing very openly, and then I'm not expected to be very politically correct. Am I? No. Yeah. Huh? Sorry? Not at all. Yeah. So, I have served in different posts in my rather undistinguished career of 10, 12 years. I've served in different posts, but initially even I had this, yes, that police, we should do something right for the society. People are oppressed, suppressed and whatnot, and they're put to so much inconvenience. Let's set some things right. About 3-4 years back, I was posted as DCP traffic in Cyberabad. Cyberabad is a commissionate which encircles Hyderabad. So I was DCP traffic there. After 3 months there, I realized, to hell with this public. choicest of words. I need not be politically correct, but I cannot talk the things that you feel sometimes. People talk of US, UK, Europe, Southeast Asia, whatever, whichever place one has visited or seen on TV. So disciplined, police is very tight, correct? Even if you violate little bit, you change the lane without an indicator, there will be a police patrol coming. Yes? You say, why doesn't in India police do all that? Yes? In US, 95% of the people follow rules. Correct? Mostly, 95%. 5% deviate. So the police there can catch this 5%. Just mirror it. Okay, that's how traffic in India is. Somebody did a study that in an hour, in a standard kilometer of road, traffic, they do a lot of studies. We can't help it, but people keep doing studies. In a standard 1 kilometer urban road in a metropolitan city, for 1 hour, somebody just did a rough counting of the number of violations that take place. Traffic violations, lane changing, wrong side, jumping the signal, whatever, all those kinds of traffic violations. He came up with some absurd figure of 3 lakh violations in 1 hour in 1 kilometer of road. You tell me how many traffic policemen does it require to police it? Can we just have the numbers to do it? Whatever technology, we're talking so much of, somebody was asking, does technology bring forth better governance? In the last thing that we were discussing, somebody was asking that. So yes, Andhra Pradesh police and Telangana police, now Telangana, I serve in Telangana now, they are considered one of the pioneers in use of technology for policing. One of the, and no denying it, some of the best technology, the latest technology in the world we are adopting for policing. So you have something called as ARLVDs, automatic red light violation detectors, just like in the West. So no traffic cop to stop you when you jump a signal. There'll be a set of sensors embedded in this junction beneath the road, and there'll be cameras. Whenever after a red light you cross, there's a red light, it'll automatically sense and the camera will take a picture. And then the challan comes to your home directly. Yes? You understood the concept? Now this is world-class technology, no denying it. The best in the world. Yes? Okay. So on that junction, first the roads are of such a quality that after 3 months it requires a relaying. Yes? Most of our roads are relayed every 3 months. At least in Hyderabad, they are relayed every 3-4 months. Then somebody then realizes after it's relayed that a drainage line is passing under it, and it has to be, again, the drainage has got damaged, that has to be repaired. So once that drainage has to be repaired, road has to be dug up and again relayed. Yes? So that sensor costing some lakhs is gone already. Okay, then these are again based on some markers. No, you have those white lines, stop lines and all that. That's where the sensor is. So that stop lines get washed away in the rain. So then the new person comes and paints a new stop line. That new stop line could be 3 feet beyond the old stop line. This sensor is geared for the old stop line. Now the sensor is, now the motorist is seeing two stop lines, one faded old stop line and one brand new stop line. Correct? So the best technology in the world, when you adapt it to Indian circumstances, may not just ever work. So it is always better to post a police constable there. I am highlighting this to tell you the challenges that Indian policing faces. And while it is very easy to ridicule somebody, make fun of somebody, say that somebody is corrupt, somebody doesn't work efficiently, one sometimes needs to factor in the challenges. There are challenges of, I'll give you another statistic. In Hyderabad, why I'm talking about traffic, you know, because this is where I started realizing that public deserve what they get. That's why I'm talking of traffic. Otherwise, there are so many other things to talk of. There was one delegation from France which had come. I mean, however, I'll spell it the French way, but I mean, I-B-O-R-D-E-U-X, Bordeaux or something they call it, okay. French, you don't know how you spell it, how they write and what they talk. So they said, they call that town as Bordeaux. So that Bordeaux is supposed to be a sister city of Hyderabad. That is some kind of a collaboration on certain issues. So these people from Bordeaux, they were talking about their French, this thing, this how traffic is. They were telling Hyderabad, your traffic doesn't seem to be very good. You know, there's a lot of traffic. How do you manage to control it and all? Then he asked me, or I asked him, I don't know, how many vehicles are there on your roads or something. He gave some number, 5 lakh or 3 lakh or whatever, something like that. Then he asked me, how many vehicles are there on your roads? I said, I don't know how many vehicles are there on my roads. We can never get a count. In India, everything you can get a fake license, fake number plate, everything. So I can't tell you how many vehicles are there. But it is a fact that every day, on Hyderabad, on the roads of Hyderabad, every day 2,000 new vehicles are added. Every day. Multiply it by 365 and then do your math. But every day 2,000 vehicles. Then he asked me, my God, how do you manage? I said, who told you we manage? Only God manages. There are certain statistics, you know. India is impossible to police. Okay, you can only make an effort at doing that. You can never completely, not at this population growth rate at least. So, these are some of the challenges. Apart from that, people talk of so many issues. People talk of, there are some other challenges, scrutiny. Police comes under intense scrutiny, which probably no other organization comes under, because what we do is every time in the open public domain, so we come under intense scrutiny. Scrutiny by public, scrutiny by civil society, scrutiny by the judiciary, scrutiny by the political executive, and of course, the worst type of scrutiny by my boss. That's there for everybody, but scrutiny, everybody scrutinizes our work. So everybody scrutinizes it their way. Ab, I'll give a small example. Somebody has had a theft in his house. Yes? Some 10 tolas of gold is gone, some TV is gone, something cash, 5 lakhs. We all keep cash in our houses in bunches. I don't know why we do. Cash and gold, every Indian family will keep in very good quantum in their house, especially in the south at least. They're in very good quantum. So that gets stolen. Then he comes to police station. So FIR ho gaya, FIR done. And the thief sometimes gets caught, sometimes doesn't get caught. Say the thief gets caught. After the thief gets caught, then now the question, $1 million question. So now we are a democracy adhering to the highest standards of human values. Yes? So I should make the thief sit. Kahan le gaya beta paisa? Have you hidden it somewhere? You least expect him to tell anything, do you? Nor does the family who has lost their belongings. Now that family wants me to bash him up, hang him upside down, do whatever but recover his every penny that he has lost. But in the evening when there is a program, some of our famed anchors on TV, the, Arnab Goswami and all, when they debate, of course I have nothing against him, but they carry on the big debates. This same family, are ye police wala isko tang do, ye marad, he will show one video where police is beating somebody. And same, you will be sitting there and say, sala, suspend karo isko, send him to jail, he should be done this with, that with. The inherent contradictions in our expectations from the police are just too many. Just too many. You want police to do everything which is suitable for you, but not for the other person. Sir, wo traffic violation, if I am caught, mera chalan likh raha, sir, udhar 10 log ja rahe na, helmet nahi pehen ke, unko kyun nahi pakde? Arre, main ek hi aadmi hu na, ek hi ko pakad do na, 10 kaisa pakad do? Oh, nobody will say, my helmet, kyun, my sir, sorry, next time helmet pehen le tu. Nobody will say that. He will say, mer ko kyun pakde, wo 10 ko kyun chode? So, the inherent contradictions in our expectations are so many that it's very difficult for a normal human being who's, I mean, the police comes from the same society as you are. And he has the same mental, physical, emotional capabilities that you have. You can't expect him to be a Rambo, no? Every policeman can't be a Rambo. Can take the heaviest of pain, be a sharpshooter at the same time, give zabardast dialogues also. It's just not possible. So, one must tone down one's expectations. Be more realistic. Just as you expect the police to be realistic, the society also is expected by us to be realistic. And not have such high expectations which we can seldom fulfill. Then there are other challenges as we often talk, political issues. That's a favorite topic, of course, but it's now quite old and very oft repeated. But yes, politicians have their due place in society. They are there to fulfill certain requirements of the public. We are a democracy. They have certain expectations which may be fair, which may be unfair. So they do communicate, and up to the incumbent person at that person, whether at that point of time, whether he wants to accept what is being told or not to accept, based on the merits, that's of course a different issue, but there are issues. Then nowadays you have a lot of legal scrutiny. The number of writ petitions, I am DCP crimes, on an average there would be at least maybe 3 writ petitions in which I would be a respondent every day. Every day there would be 3 writs filed in High Court in which I or the branch which works under me has to. You register a case that somebody has cheated you. The moment I go, if somebody has registered a FIR, the first work for me is to go and examine him, know what has happened. The moment you go and touch that person, he goes to court and files a writ. So the legal issues, the legal challenges are quite a lot. Not that they are unfounded, but there are challenges. Then of course, scrutiny by media. When there is nothing else to show on TV, then police, you will certainly find something. If you take a camera and roam around Hyderabad, you will certainly find some shots which you can discuss in the evening. Natural, because you see policemen, all of us are on the roads most of the time. So you will find something we do which is not absolutely right. These are some of the challenges. But it's not that I just keep cribbing and there's nothing that we can do. Police is doing, has been doing a lot. It's not that they were not doing, and they are continuing to do whatever is possible in their stride, including the favorite buzzword, technology. We are one of, we are almost on the forefront of adapting technology for our regular work, whether it is cyber crime, regular crime, forensic analysis, communications, data, analysis of big data. You must be very surprised that I am talking of a police wala ko big data kaise malum ho gaya. Big data to hum hi log baat karte. We do a lot of analysis of big data to catch criminals. Then what other aspects? Administrative, normal administrative work. Police in this country, say the total police strength in this country is close to 2 million. Do you know that? It's a huge, I mean, it's not one organization as such, but when you add up different states, central paramilitary organizations, all that, when you add up, it's a huge figure. And let me tell you that even today, police does perform. And you will be surprised that one of the best performing agencies, I can say with absolute conviction, in the government is police. If you need anything to be done, and done fast, done efficiently, it's very often the police that delivers. In fact, recently in Telangana, they have been talking a lot about bringing police officers to a lot of other departments, like commercial taxes, like health, transport. That's the truth. It was out in papers. I don't have paper clippings, but there are a lot of debate to bring police officers. Why? Because police is a very unique organization. In spite of his numerous fallacies, there are certain very, inherent abilities that a policeman or the organization develops over a period of time. I told you certain challenges now, no? It is because of these challenges that a policeman or the organization develops certain excellent capabilities. One is to the ability to perform under absolute stress. Absolute stress, whatever be the stress, a policeman will deliver to some extent. He might not deliver completely, but he's able to deliver. And I'm sure if he's not a policeman, he will not be able to deliver that. The ability to work in cohesion. Just now there was this photo about magnets and everybody work in cohesion to achieve a certain goal. In police, that comes about not because show them the common goals or show them the shared responsibilities, nothing like that. It's an organizational hierarchy and orders are almost always followed. So that makes, if police, the boss decides that something right is to be done, almost everybody falls in line. Then the ability to respond very quickly, which no other organization probably in this country has. Because the number of emergencies, the number of critical situations that police responds to, whether it's a riot, a flood, accident, almost always it is the police which is the first responder. Though in cinemas, police is usually the last, but modern day policing, we are usually the first. So these are some of the core abilities of police due to which police delivers, and that's why there's talk of police officers being called to head different agencies. In fact, at a recent meeting, the Chief Minister of Telangana was telling that the investments that are coming into state are primarily because of the excellent law and order atmosphere. Because the global investors who want to come in, the first thing that they ask about a place is, How is the law and order atmosphere in your state or your city or your town or whatever place? And then comes the other questions, whether electricity is good, water supply is good, do you have good civic facilities and all. But the primary requirement for any place to develop is good law and order where its citizens can stay safely. And this has been, this was told by him, and this has come out of late. This is a new trend that I am seeing in papers and different debates and discussions, that how law and order has of late, I mean earlier also it was there, but of late it has come to occupy a very primary position in the scheme of things. At this, I'll just show you a small video. It's not that I'm doing any advertisement, but just to, you can think for yourself, see for yourself. Who put this back again? Pen drive, yes, please. Max, how do you maximize it?
Please do that.
Sound is there? This was an old video, quite some time old, about 90, late 90s, okay. That's not me, that's my father, so the name. Sound? Can increase the volume. There, that's it.
देते हैं जीवन तुम पे हम अपना ही समझो हमको तुम हर मुश्किल में तेरी सेवा करेंगे हम होंगे कुर्बान एक दिन कोई नहीं है गम प्राणों से भी प्यारा हमको अपना वतन तेरी खुशहाली ही मेरा धर्म देते हैं जीवन हम सबका सख्त बदन हम बनाते हैं तेरे ही वास्ते हर दिन हमको निपटना है दंगों से ये अंगारों से जलते रास्ते
प्रेस बाबू प्रेस नो फोटो नो एंट्रेंस कल देख लो न्यूज प्रेस फ्रीडम सप्रेस्ड पुलिस अरेगेंस
अरे परीक्षा में जाना है यार अरे स्टूडेंट से पंगा मत ले छोड़ दे
ओफो क्या हालत कर डाली ट्रैफिक डाइवर्शन डेली बंदोबस्त हर गली हम लोग सारे कीड़े मकोड़े वीआईपी सारे देवता हम लोगों को तो फिजूल समझता है क्या है
सत्यानाशी हाथ छोड़ दे पानी तेरा बाप भरेगा क्या नीच कहीं का चल चल लाइन लगा के सारा दिन हो गया
ए कबूतर मैं कौन हूँ क्या हूँ जानता नहीं तू नक्सलाइट एरिया में भिजवा दूंगा बम ब्लास्टिंग में मरवा दूंगा जय जवान भारत महान ये श्रद्धांजलि सुनाऊंगा
देते हैं जीवन तुम पे हम
थैंक
आजादी हम सबका सख्त बदन, हम बनाते हैं तेरे ही वास्ते, हर दिन हमको निपटना है दंगों से, ये अंगारों से जलते रास्ते, तेरी रक्षा में खड़ी भर चैन की ना सांस पाते, तेरे दामन को बचाने गोलियां सीने पे खाते, अपने चारों तरफ चाहे कुछ हो, सनन सनन आए आंधियां, मौत भी जो आए ना रुकेंगे, सबसे पहले अपना आशिया, जान भी दे के हम करते हैं बंदगी, देते हैं जीवन तुम पे हम, तुम पे हम अपना ही समझो, हमको तुम, हमको तुम, हर मुश्किल में तेरी सेवा करेंगे हम, होंगे कुर्बान एक दिन कोई नहीं है गम, प्राणों से भी प्यारा हमको अपना वतन, तेरी खुशहाली ही मेरा धर्म, देते हैं जीवन तुम पे हम, तुम पे हम।
Very old music video made sometime in 90s, late 90s, but I'm sure what it conveys is as clear even today. How much ever somebody criticizes the police, how much ever anybody vilifies, makes jokes, that never comes in the way of police working, nor does it ever bring that sense of antipathy towards the very people the police is serving. They serve with the same fervor, passion to the society, which very often discredits them. Now when we're talking of this, very often nowadays we talk of this section of society which is not happy. There are always a certain group of people in society who are not happy with what's happening in society. And then that takes the extreme we were just discussing outside. The extreme of these take to certain means and methods. You call them extremists, you call them fundamentalists, you call them Naxalites, terrorists, whatever. These are all a minute section of society which is somehow, and always you find certain people like this who are, for reason or no reason, unhappy with the society. And then to express their discontent, they resort to extreme means. Extreme means most often reflects in violence. I have served for about 6 years in Chhattisgarh, the district called Bijapur. I was SP of a district called Bijapur. I was ASP of a place called Narayanpur. I was also SP of a special task force there, which is primarily like a special unit to do operations on left-wing extremism. People, when they talk, no, when people talk, I often see debates, I often see people talking outside. You know, sometimes you should realize, people talk without even realizing what the ground realities in a certain place are. People talk of police excesses, people talk of why Naxalites are killed, they are our own people, why police has to resort to so much violence. Sometimes we don't understand why this whole thing has come to be. Especially, I'll talk of South Bastar. You have heard of Bastar? Most of you have, yes. Erstwhile, Bastar was one district sometime in the 90s and prior to that. It was the largest district in the country. It was 45,000 square kilometers large, bigger than the state of Kerala. So most of Naxalism is, but I'd say the purest form of left-wing extremism or Naxalism, as what they envisaged. Naxalism has a theory behind it, has a certain ideology which they aim to practice and execute on the ground. It's not just a theory, but they aim to, and in fact they have succeeded, they had succeeded in large tracts of areas to have it on the ground. And Bastar is one such place where it exists in its entire purity, that whole structure, how you should have at the village level, then you have at the divisional level, then area level, then, I mean, they're this thing, they have something called a Politburo, Central Committee, almost proper organization. Why? Probably because in the last 30, 40 years, or maybe longer than that, that area, due to certain policies, good, bad, we can debate that endlessly, but it was left as it is, untouched. Untouched by too much development, untouched by too much political activity, untouched by administrative intervention. When you have an area like that, you are automatically creating a vacuum for certain elements to step in. And they step in along with their ideology, and they've had a free time of 30, 40 years there to spread that ideology, to get it properly ingrained in the minds of the local population, which is mainly tribal in that area. And a great advantage there is the natural forest. I have never seen, I mean, there could be places, but the forests of Bastar are, even today, so dense and so pristine that one would really enjoy if it was not Naxalite affected. Teak grows in its abundance in Bastar, and even today the best quality of teak in India, probably after Burma, they say Burma teak is the best in the world. So after Burma teak, this teak is considered to be, and you know the tribals there very often use teak for firewood. There is so much teak there. And this kind of environment gave them a very good breeding ground. And then it came on till the late 90s, 2000s, when the skirmishes started with the government and the Naxalites. When government started to enter the area and all that, then the skirmishes started. You had these firefights with policemen and all. And then sometime in 2005, in Bijapur, there's a place called Kutru. You've heard of the word Salva Judum? Yes. Oh, you're all very well aware. At your age, Salva Judum didn't happen, but Salva Judum, you've heard. Kutru was a place in Bijapur where this Salva Judum started. Salva Judum was basically what you call one group of tribal population which rose up against another group of tribal population due to Naxalism, because Naxalism spread an ideology of atheism. They said the tribal culture and all, they showed them in poor light. So that's something which a section of the society there didn't like it, and in the same village one group was created against another, and this resulted in something called as Salva Judum. Salva Judum means in the dialect over there, Judum means Jodna, everybody together. Salva means everybody. So everybody together. So they rose up against them. And then Naxalites wanted to suppress the Judum people who are associated with Judum. And these people came out of their villages and came and settled at pockets where police concentration was there. So then the Salva Judum camps, the so-called infamous, you would have heard of the Salva Judum camps. So the Salva Judum camps were established, and almost 50,000 people at one point of time were living in these camps. You might think 50,000 is a very small number, but considering that the population of entire Bijapur district was 2 lakhs only, so 50,000 is 1/4 of the population almost. So we had 14 camps in Bijapur. These people used to stay. Because they were locals, the government took a policy there to enlist the fit and able youth as SPOs. So they were taken as special police officers. There's something in the police act called as special police officer, wherein any civilian can be made a special police officer if the situation demands. The SP of the district can enlist any person as a special police officer and give him the powers of a policeman because the situation demands. So because there were a lot of youth there and fit and able people, so they were enlisted as SPOs and made to work with police. So very often it came in TV, news, media, different sections and this thing that Salwa Judum people were armed and they were made to fight one against the other. But that was not the case. There were people, civilians, who were made SPOs, trained and made to help the police because at that point of time, police strength was very less. I don't know if you recollect, in 2007, there was a massive attack on a police post in Rani Bodli, where 55 policemen were killed in one single attack. Then of course that 76 in Dantewada happened much later in 2010. But this, so this 2007, this Rani Bodli, after that, the government started recruiting police in large numbers, pumping in lot of resources, putting up proper camps and all. But till then, police had to be supplemented with additional manpower. So these SPOs were used and then it led to a lot of things. Then that Supreme Court judgment, which came sometime in 2010, and then Supreme Court said SPOs should be used for a specific purpose and all. Okay, we can debate the right and wrong, but I'm telling you what situation was at that point of time and why it had to happen. I'll show you a few photographs. How many of you have been to Bastar? 4 people, 5 people, okay. How do you max? This is maximum. Please help me. I'll just show you a few photos. What I am showing you here is establishment of a police camp. How you establish is just sheer forest. Okay. Even if you have to establish a police camp somewhere, because Naxalites are dead against roads and cell phone towers. Okay, when I was SP Bijapur in 2009, the entire district had just 2 mobile towers. Okay, and there were at that point of time some 23 police stations in the district, and out of that I think 3 or 4 police stations didn't have electricity lines running up to them, to that village. They used to run on solar power and generator. And in the thick of Naxalite area, and sometimes in the rainy seasons when the sun, there's no solar light, generator diesel runs out because it's diesel, even if it has to be taken there, a proper operation has to be planned because otherwise you could be attacked. And also sometimes, and the rivulets and the streams, sometimes they get full and you can't cross them. There are no bridges. So you have to wait for the water to recede and then go there. So sometimes generator runs out, solar runs out. The only thing SP has to do is pray that my post is okay, because I am not able to talk to them. There are no phones. Satellite phone needs a battery. The battery runs out. Everything is there. So just to hope that they are all okay, you need to pray that they are all fine and good. So this is some photos I just gathered. A new camp was being opened. So I just picked up some of those old photos. So you have to first set up these kind of things. These embankments, you have to make those embankments there. Because when you set up a camp, nothing comes in. You first have to set up, then slowly things start pouring in. And this, I'm not talking of some remote corner of India. This is right heart of central India. So to protect yourself against Naxalites, fire and all, you make these embankments and things like that, and then you protect yourself. These are, the first thing you do is take a boring machine there, get a borewell dug. Without water, you can't survive. So you have to get a borewell dug, then set up your camp and all that. Okay, I'm just showing you some photos. I'll ask you a question. They're all off the same road, okay, at different locations. Yes? This is, my dear friends, in 2009, National Highway 202. Okay, and when people talk of so many different aspects, I sometimes feel like, I'm sure the road hasn't changed too much even today. Though the highway is planned, I think at some point of time it will come up, but this is what the road is like. This is one of our furthermost police stations in Bijapur. This was Tarlaguda, almost on AP border, overlooking river Godavari. You can see the police station building. Very difficult to do any kind. These are the solar lights and these on which the police stations usually used to run. This is how we used to cross the river. There's no bridge, as you can see. This is how the police has to, when you transfer men, when you move, somebody has to come out on leave, somebody has to go. So this is how you can see them carrying their weapons and crossing and all. You have to do a plan a proper operation each time one has to do that. This was the river Godavari then. Yeah, that's just the photo, just to show you what sometimes what the world we know and we debate and we discuss is not the world we know. We are assuming something and then we debate and discuss. So one should never pass a judgment. That's something I always tell everybody. One should never pass a judgment until you have been into it and know what it is. Otherwise, it would be absolute presumption to say that somebody is bad, somebody is good. One of the most successful states in doing anti-Naxal operations was undoubtedly AP. Then AP, almost they have wiped out Naxalism from the state. And as a part of doing that, apart from police operations development, they also did some propaganda and good publicity in the public. I'll show you another. Do you have a good volume now? I'll just show you this photo because we talk so much about Naxalism. So there's a small music video which was made at that point of time to show the people. Hey, volume, hey, yeah. We'll be right back.
क्या हो किसको ये पता, हत्या करवा के तुझको जीवन भर उलझा देंगे, ये जाल बिछा है ऐसा क्यों आके फंसा, रे ये काम नहीं है तेरा इंसान नहीं तू ऐसा, हथियारों के जंगल में क्यों आके घुसा, इस बार जो इस दलदल में फंसे वो भागने ना पाए, हर ओर तेरे आगे मौत खड़ी। ये घोर अंधेरे हैं कोई ठंडी छांव नहीं, रातों का भरोसा करके जंगल की ओर न जा, सूरज की किरणें क्यों आंखों में खटकती है, तू छोड़ दे नादानी आ लौट के घर आ जा।
Terrorist is no man's friend, whatever that form may be, whether it is left-wing extremism or terrorism in Punjab or J&K or Northeast. Everybody has grievances, don't you? Even I have grievances, you have grievances. A democracy provides for proper recourse to sort our grievances out. Some may take longer, shorter, good, bad, whatever. But there is a process. Better follow that process, because if they don't and do something like this, these are all based on real things which have happened. These are not pure fiction. These things do happen, and they do happen in any extremism environment. Any, whether it is left-wing or J&K or any such kind of things happen. And they happen, then the full might of the law should be used to bring them to justice. There is no other solution, because every day then somebody will have a grievance and he will pick up a gun. Where do you stop that? So there is no debate sometimes on this. If something is wrong, it is wrong. There is no two sides, no gray. People say shades of gray. Law, there is only right and there is wrong. If it is wrong, then the right will use the full might of the law to put down the wrong. And that's, I think, I very genuinely believe is a solution for most things. And one must do it whenever it is required. That was all, I think, I would like to put to you. I didn't want, when it was about what civil services can do, should do, police can do, but what we can do, what we should do, we can keep on debating. But what I wanted to tell you is what is. What is, because you're all intelligent people and especially so here, because that's what Shobhit was telling, that all thinking people are here. So please think before you decide. Thank you.
So raise your hand and we'll have a mic come to you and only then ask a question. Okay, we have one mic on that side, one mic on this side, okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, you spoke about how you wanted to talk about what is, and most of us, or if it's a common misconception, that police, they associate with corruption. And I was wondering, because you were talking about it earlier, I was wondering, and one side of it or one avenue is the political pressures that bureaucrats face in civil services in general, in policemen in particular, in an urban or rural setting. I was hoping you'd talk more about what some experience you might have had, or you can name names, you cannot, it's up to you. But.
Look, I always say when people say about talk about political pressure, am I audible? I'm usually also audible if I switch off the mic. So when people talk about political pressure, everybody has a place in society. Everybody. Policeman, a criminal, a politician, a bureaucrat, a doctor, engineer, whatever. Everybody has a place in society. A politician is there to do a certain aspect of society's work. And he will certainly have some expectations, either his own or brought on him by the people or the constituency of people he services. Some of these expectations might be right, some of them may be wrong. But definitely it is his right to put forward what he thinks to a policeman, whether it's a SHO, or it is a SP or DCP or whatever rank, or a constable, whoever is there. It is up to the policeman who's there on the spot, the position, to take a call on it. He has certain laws to follow. He has certain guidelines, rules to follow. He has certain role to fulfill. He can factor all that in. And certainly, last but not the least, his own conscience to decide what is right and wrong and do. Nobody is stopping him from doing the right thing. If he does the right thing, there could be some repercussions. There may not be certain repercussions. We always imagine that there would be repercussions. There might not be certain repercussions. But there is nothing which prevents him from doing the right thing. General parlance will talk about transfer. You do the right thing, you'll be transferred out. That's what I'm sure most of you will would have heard or something. So be it. Be transferred, so be transferred. Anyway, it's a transferable job. When you join the service, you have not said that I'll sit in the same chair till time comes. I'll be transferred about as many times in my career. Now, on an average, till traffic, my average tenure in a post was about 8 months, I think. After that, from traffic, I spent 3 years in traffic. And then, of course, DCP crime, I'm there for the last 1 year. So that's about it. Otherwise, I don't think there's an issue. I never had an issue. I'll do what I think is right. You do what you think is right. Everybody has a role to play. I think you are, hands are up since.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, you spoke about how the police faces, you know, they have to do additional certain duties that it's not written anywhere they need to do it. But sir, the same thing can even be said about the Indian Army. Like even during disasters and all, even they are coming forward and helping. So sir, my question is, what do you have to say about the law and order situation in Kashmir? Because in Kashmir, the question always comes between terrorists and the Indian Army. There's no mention of the police in Kashmir.
I've never worked in Kashmir, so it would not be right for me to, speculate or pass a judgment on what's right or what's wrong. It's not that J&K police, we had visited J&K during certain of our courses and certain attachments and all. I didn't tell that to compare the army and the police. I told it to bring into perspective that why police is in a situation that it is. Army is called in to perform certain lot of duties, but they have a very, they have a lot of clarity in what they have to do. There would be rare circumstances where the clarity would be less, maybe like a present situation in J&K or sometimes in Northeast, but more often than not, there is a lot of clarity. And as regards J&K police, I think J&K police has, by all parameters, by all, opinion, both of officers and public, in the last 2-3 decades, they have performed exceedingly well. They have certain very good teams of the SOG, they call it Special Operations Group in J&K, which has taken on very big, been at the forefront of many operations and had got very good results. So it's not that J&K police doesn't do anything, but there are certain situations there which call for probably the army intervention. That is in the wisdom of the, top brass of the Indian governance. So in their wisdom, they have put it there. And everybody has a role to play there. Who said, that was you, was last, yes. We'll come down from last row. So with time, 15 minutes.
Sir, I was interning with Human Rights Commission sometime back, and we realized that the maximum cases, complaints were against the police, and they were about custodial death and torture. So sir, like, what do you have to say about that?
No denying custodial death is unlawful, and there is no justification for a custodial death or a torture. There is nothing to justify it. What I am saying is you should not expect that when you are a affected party, police go to any extent to recover your things, but not do it for others. There should be no torture in custody. There should be no death in custody. That is totally condemnable. If it has happened by accident and it is proved, then it's okay. Something has happened because a person naturally suffers a heart attack, then nothing police can do about it. But police doing something which causes a death or a torture, and it's not acceptable at all. What I said was one should not expect police to do something like that. That's what I said. There's a clash of expectations. People still now come to me, sir, usko thoda laga hai toh sab sach batata, sir. And we nowadays we have learned ab zamana change ho gaya, wo jitna sach mila utna hi milta, baki sach nahi milta. Last row, both of you, then we'll come to the row below that.
Experience of a counter Naxalite operation you participated in, because sir, after so many years of counter operations, still the problem of Naxalism persists. So, can you please share an experience of a counter-Naxalism operation that you took, that you participated in, means ground?
As ASPs and even sometimes as SP, we have gone for operations. Operation is by itself a very, not as glamorous as it sounds on TV. It's very painful. You walk and walk and walk. Sleeping in the night in the forest is like, it's not as romantic as it made out to be. One night in the forest, in the morning you'll be drenched and shivering. So because of the dew, your shoes will be wet, your dress will be wet, everything is going to get wet. You have to keep, you can't have a picnic in the forest because you have to be quiet. You can't, jungle mangal type, nothing to do there. You have to be very this thing, and operation typically would last for 3-4 days and all, because there are different type of operation. Na? Anti-terrorist, if you are doing a room intervention, it's different from a jungle operation. Jungle operations typically exert a lot of, they require a lot of stamina. You have to keep on going. Sometimes you will move 3 days and not come across any Naxalite group or what, where you have an exchange of fire or something. Typically, one would be happy if you spend 3 days and have an exchange of fire. As it was at least worth it. I went to the jungle, something happened. 3 days you roam out in the jungle, come back, nothing has happened. You get frustrated. So jungle operations are very, very strenuous, and it requires a lot of perseverance, planning, and unlike what is shown in movies, अरे fire उधर से आ रहा, जवाब दो, जब पहला गोली चलता है कहाँ से आ रहा समझ में ही नहीं आता. That is a jungle, no? It echoes everywhere. You just don't realize where the bullet. Sometimes you डर लगता है कि अपने वाले अपने को नहीं मार देते. So one has to plan very carefully. It is not at all glamorous. I've been in an exchange of fire a couple of times, not more than that. Otherwise, I've gone like this and come back frustrated. So, but yes, of course, as SP, you plan a lot of operations on inputs and all. You get good results also sometimes, whatever you may call that to be. But operations have a mixed bag. We'll come down to the, yeah, please.
Good morning, sir. In Indian police, there is only 6.11% of women. So what's your take on this, the participation of women in Indian police?
No, women part is increasing now.
Yeah.
Almost every state has, trying to have a certain quota for a woman and encouraging women to come. In fact, earlier the facilities for, women who are serving in police were not that adequate. Now a conscious effort is being made to provide adequate restrooms and other facilities which women are comfortable, so that when they're comfortable when they're working. So that effort is being consistently being made, and encourage more and more women to join the police, that's being done. Because 50% of the population is women, so you need as many in the police to deal with that, and women are very tough to deal with on the ground. Yeah, second.
Good morning, sir. My question is specific to the Operation Green Hunt that was at its peak near 2010. So there was this narrative that came out to be like, if the CRPF is not succeeding, army can be deployed. But a counter narrative came that is, if army is deployed, that would amount that a civil war is going on in India. So somewhere Naxalites, there was this thing like Naxalites maybe treated equivalent to the civilians, that was why army was not intended to be deployed. So what's your take on that? Like you said, like terrorism is terrorism, whether it's on the Indo-Pak border in Kashmir or on the forest of Chhattisgarh. So what is your take on that?
I'll come to my take or not my take, but I'll just tell you, how many of you have heard the word Green Hunt? Quite a few have heard. Oh, you're very well read. I thought only we know about those things. But I'll tell you a small story how that word came to be coined about. People think Green Hunt is a big operation which is going around in the forest of Chhattisgarh and all that at that point of time. There was one, I was SP Bijapur, and my batchmate was SP Dantewada, and we had our zonal IG Bastar, Mr. Long Kumar. There was one area between Dantewada and Bijapur. There's one police station called Mirtur on this side, and I forget on Dantewada, there's one dense forested area. So there was some inputs about some large group of Naxalites being there. So a joint operation was planned. All three of us sat together, we planned that operation, we sent in some parties, we had some exchange of fire, something was recovered and all that. So that operation, our IG, we were together, something we should name it, and when you are doing such kind of things day in and day out, you want to bring some joy in your life, at least by naming them or something. So we decided we'll call it Green Hunt, that specific operation. So that term was coined for that. Then somehow press got the hang of it and it became the buzzword for everything that happened in Bastar, Green Hunt. So actually it was the name of a very specific operation. Now coming to whether army has to tackle or police has to tackle, most internal security issues police has the capabilities or very close to the capabilities. They can be developed, like AP, as I said, AP tackled Naxalism very well. It was entirely police and supported by paramilitary forces like CRPF and all, but primarily led by the state police. So even in Chhattisgarh, the capabilities of police and the right leadership is given, they can tackle. That's not an issue. Army to be brought in or not, that is government to decide. I was just talking to somebody. We can't solve all the problems of the world, nor I can tell solutions for everything in the world. One can only talk about the perspective that one faces. So I feel, yes, police properly equipped, trained, and well led, I think the problem can be tackled.
What do you think is the relationship between the Maoist and an Adivasi? Because Adivasi, at times, if someone is feeling exploitative, he goes to the Maoist also.
I told you initially only when I was talking, I told there was some vacuum there in that area. And that vacuum, administrative, political, economic, social, that vacuum was filled in by the Naxalites and now as we call them Maoists. And when a certain space is occupied by a certain group of people over a long period of time, it is a challenge to sort that thing out. So because that happen, that area happens to be more populated by tribal people, so naturally they would have a relationship. But there was, again, as I told Salva Judum, a very large group of tribals who revolted against Naxalites because they felt the ideas being propagated by Naxalites were not in tune with their own culture and their own society. So it works both ways.
Sir, we all know that IPS are under immense pressure, but sir, you look so relaxed. So sir, can you suggest us how you are managing your stress level?
People often ask this question. I don't know why I never really felt any stress. So I would not be, probably because I've been seeing it. I can share with you, my father was an IPS officer. He was 1975 batch IPS. Of course, I am there. My younger brother, he's 2011 batch IPS. And my maternal grandfather was first batch of IPS, 1948 batch. In Hindi you say Mausa. Mausa, we tell Mausa. My mother's elder sister's husband, Mausa, correct? Mausa, he was IPS 67 batch. So probably because I saw a lot of IPS officers, or it's my personal disposition that I love to give tension to others and don't bother too much. I don't know, but every job has its share of tensions. You tell me, I have seen my cousins and all who work in the private sector draw huge salaries. They're always so tensed. Probably because that 1-0 might go, or 1-0 when it's going to get added. So everybody has their own share of tensions, I think. It's how you take it.
So, firstly, I truly admire the way you shared your experiences with us. And the question I have is about the training that goes to counter disasters like terrorist attacks. So I come from Mumbai, and we had a terrorist attack in 2008. And we got to, so the Mumbai police gave in everything they had to counter it. But there were a lot of flaws, like they were not well equipped. and they were not trained to usually they reach the crime after the crime is done, but this time they had to face the criminals while they were doing it. And so what has been done or what is being done to really counter
everybody, whether it's you, me, police, anybody, learns from their experiences. Everybody. And everybody has a first time of a certain experience. So probably that experience was for the first time for Mumbai police. They did their best at that time, but probably they didn't face a situation like that earlier, so they were not equipped at that point of time. I'm sure, and I've read also that after that they have upgraded their training, their equipment, their weapons, everything. And they're now pretty much equipped to face. So when a situation happens, some things would follow from the past, some new things would happen. One has to respond at that point of time, but learn from the experience and see that you don't repeat the same mistake twice. That happens everywhere in Naxalite operations, in Mumbai, in normal theft cases also, same thing. If you get burgled once, the second time you'll put some cameras, add some more steel, this thing, iron to your windows, you'll do something, no? Same for police. Yeah, or row, that row.
Good afternoon, I'm Lakeshwar, I'm from Chhattisgarh. Sir, in spite of taking a lot of measures to tackle Naxalism in Chhattisgarh, for the last, in around 2010, Superintendent of Police Dantewada, Mr. Vinod Chauhan, was shot dead by Naxalite. And then in May 25th, 2014, 30 leaders along with State Congress President and Vidya Charan Shukla and leader of the Salwar Jalu, Mahendra Karma, was shot dead by Naxalite. And in recent, in March and April 25 and 16, CRPF Jawans were killed by the Naxalite. I think the problem has not been solved yet, in spite of taking measures. But my question is on HR part, the human resource part, as far as the facilities, given by the government to police men, especially to constable and head constable, they don't have even residential quarter for them. 24/7 duties and no flexible timing of, duty hours. So, what the government is thinking in your views to, tackle this type of, hygiene factor for the policeman?
Just as your salary is fixed, but your needs are very flexible, government also has a certain pie, a budget. And then it has, there are so many aspirations to be met. Government has to meet so many aspirations. Any government, whether it's Chhattisgarh, central government, if the money inflow is limited, no, that much as the government would like to wish to do away with all the problems, the government will not be able to have the wherewithals to address it. It cannot say that this year I will not spend any 1 rupee on agriculture and give the entire money to police, or I will neglect industries and transfer it. It cannot, everything has to be spread and balanced every year. So as the years pass, the facilities are definitely improving. As I was SP of Bijapur, in my tenure itself, I saw some improvement because money used to come in, construction used to happen. Before me, what the SPs faced, I faced lesser. Now I'm sure the SPs who are there, they would be in much better position for their people and all. So that keeps happening. And problem persists. Nobody debates that the problem persists. Such a big problem will take some time to go. And it will go, certainly, there is no doubt about that. It is certainly going to go, but it will take some time depending on the situation, the capabilities, the leadership, a lot of things. It will take some time. And sometimes, in spite of things happening, we repeat mistakes. That's human nature, human nature. Even after, if you are told, don't walk on the right side of the road, walk on the left side of the road, for 364 days you might walk, but one day you might commit a mistake out of something. And the other side needs to be lucky only once. The police needs to be lucky all 365 days. So sometimes it's not possible. Things happen. You learn and see that the mistakes are not repeated. Each time if it is repeated, you take some corrective measures. Yeah.
From the other side of the spectrum. So the question I want to ask is a little different from the issue you raised. Do you think there's an imminent disconnect between the IPS officers and the rest of the police force? And if yes, how far do you think is it a systemic problem?
Our primary job is to implement the law. We are accountable by a, I mean, the system of governance in our country is not direct democracy, no? It's not that people say, I want this 100 people say, and I do that thing. People elect the legislature. Legislature passes a certain legislation. That legislation, subordinate legislation is created, government orders are there. And I, as the executive, have to work in accordance with that. I cannot work directly in accordance with public, what public demands. Today, public might demand, no, we don't want helmet rule. Tomorrow, public will say, no, let us, this part of the road, it is damaged, so we'll drive on the wrong side. Because that is public convenience. But I don't have the mandate to directly take care of public opinion. As regards a disconnect, I think that is, that depends on place to place and system to system, officer to officer. There could be some places where there are disconnect, there could be some places where there is no disconnect. But as long as the police is following the law and doing the right thing, even if there is a slight disconnect between the aspirations of the people and the police, I think that's okay. Because aspirations can never be met 100%. Take Shobit's permission. 1:30.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Ajay. I'm from the state of Telangana. The thing is that we have an Indian Police Act of 1861. And the most waiting part, and it is the longest kept pending proposal with the government, that we need to bring reforms to that particular act. And recently in the state of Telangana, we can see many people like from the rank of sub-inspector are committing suicides because of some huge tremendous pressure. So what do you say that even in the in Supreme Court has made a judgment in 2006, the states to take up this reforms in this Indian Police Act in order to like strengthen the police system, also like relaxing them at some times. So what do you say on this?
There are efforts underway. I think some states have passed new police acts, which are, some are in conformity, some are not in entire conformity, something like some states are planning to pass, some states is being on the process and all. But police act per se doesn't ensure better policing or rest and relaxation for the police. What is required for that so-called rest and relaxation for the staff is adequate number of policemen. When you're talking of being off on a Sunday, if I lock the police station on a Sunday and everybody goes off, how is it going to work? And trouble for police, today there's a riot, no, wait, tomorrow Monday, today Sunday, rest. There is no such system. If it's a Sunday, everybody has to respond, your Sunday is gone. If I don't respond, you will forget about holiday for police and start criticizing the police, correct? If today I say Sunday something took place, no, everybody's at home relaxing. Nobody can come today, rest. You will not accept that, no? Will you accept that? No. So, one has to strike a balance, and it's not that nothing is being done on that. It is being contemplated, whatever is possible is being thought of. Sometimes it's happening fast, sometimes it's not happening fast, but I'm sure things will improve as they happen. I've got stronger, his hand is up.
Thank
since.
You, sir. Sir, my question pertains to the police and paramilitary services. Sir, the armed in places where the Armed Forces Special Powers Act has been implemented, there have been allegations that the police and paramilitary services have violated human rights. Now, in your experience, do you believe that these allegations are either true or justified? And if they are, then what can be done to solve them? Some people have said that the act should be repealed. Is this, in your opinion, a viable option?
First, I'll come answer the smaller question. I am generally averse to taking the big questions of life. I am happy answering the small things in life and just moving ahead. As regards human rights violations, everything has to be taken on a case-to-case basis. You can't generalize. Human rights violation, udhar human right violation ho raha hai, uska kya matlab hai? For reading in a newspaper, it makes sense, but otherwise, how does it make sense? You have to take it, okay. इसका ह्यूमन राइट वायलेशन हुआ क्या राइट का वायलेशन हुआ कौन किया हाउ इट हैपेंड हु डिड दैट whether any right was violated, if so, which one, how, everything that. So it is a case-to-case basis. It cannot be generalized first. So if there is any violation of any right of any citizen, and if it is not in accordance with law, the concerned officer or person who has done the violation has to respond to that, and necessary action, disciplinary, criminal, whatever action needs to be taken as per the situation should be taken. There is no debating that. But as regards this Armed Forces Special Powers Act, there are certain situations where, like we talked, no, army plays, generally has clear-cut roles, primarily for to face external aggression. But there are certain situations where army plays a role which is not very clear. So there, to equip these forces, certain powers have been given. So again, how these powers are being used, whether they are being misused, that is again a case to case. It's not that in 100% cases it's being misused. There is a possibility that there are certain cases where it's being misused. So that has to be investigated, and if it's being misused, then necessary action can be taken. And police never requires Armed Forces Special Powers Act, because police functions under the normal law wherever, whatever is the criminal procedure code or the IPC, it functions. Yeah? Life is very simple. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Sir, as far as the Maoism is concerned, to what extent do you think the development model of the state can solve the problem of Maoism? Because one, Maoist suggests a different model of development, and two, violence from state, counter-violence from state only kills Maoists and not their ideology.
I don't read too many papers. I don't analyze such complicated statements too often. We have resolved to have a form of governance in the constitution. Yes? Our forefathers decided this is the best form of governance. And they have also decided in constitution that if you want to change something, there is a way in which it can be changed. Correct? So, if you want to change the way of governance, the address the aspirations of the people, and please do by all means. Who's preventing you? You elect a government which will do that. Let that government do it through legislation, and let the orders be passed. Let us do it. Otherwise, as a society, we will cease to exist as a civilized society. If every day somebody decides that something is not happening right, and I need to counter that right, and I need to pick up a weapon for that, then we've had it. And as regards state violence, there is nothing called state violence. The CRPC section 129 enables a police officer to use as much force as required as the situation demands to disperse or to deal with a unlawful assembly. Okay, law itself provides for a police officer to deal. Police officer means a group of policemen or whatever. And in the course of duty, if somebody intervenes or attacks the police has every right to take countermeasures as required. So it is not state violence. It is state action as perceived by the law.